in government schools. More and more people shift their children from government school, of course the most affordable ones they send to vernacular schools, but there are more and more Malays, for example, sent to private schools, sent to you go and ask the UMNO ministers, you know, lo and behold, a lot of them will send their children to international school, for example. In fact, it was during BN's time 4 years ago that they suddenly opened up the international schools for common enrollment. Used to be that only expats can send children to international schools. So the real issue is actually not whether you are Chinese, vernacular school, whether it's interaction, whether it's assimilation, whether it's polarization. It goes back to what have become of our government school. I believe in options. And I think Malaysia started out in the 70s, in the 60s, in the 80s, where the school of choice for the people is government school. It's not the vernacular schools. It's because of the failure of the government schools that more and more people are shifting to other schools, especially vernacular schools, and the lalat is back. And that's why I think, to the question of vernacular schools, what is most important is to fix our schools, our government schools, because once you fix the government schools, you will see a return to government school from the non-Malays and Malays alike. And eventually, the presence of vernacular schools is going to be a matter of choice for some parents. If they really think that they still want to send their children to Chinese vernacular school, when your government school can provide a better standard of education, can educate their children with an equally good Mandarin education, if the discipline and prospect of government school is better than your Chinese vernacular school, anyone in their right mind, whether they are Chinese, Indian, or Malays, or Mat Saleh, or you name it, Kadazan, they will send their children to government school. So the priority, don't shift the focus away from the real problem, which is the failure of the current government that has really brought down the standard of our school. And the second point about this vernacular school and polarization. From that small town of Kemaman, I actually went to Malay College in Kuala Kangsar, where all the students were Malays. By decree, it has to be Malay and Muslims. So I didn't have any schoolmate from a different race for 5 years. Yet, I had, you know, I can speak for myself, that I had a very enriching multicultural, multiracial exposure in the school. Not from among the students, but from among the teaching faculties. So another failure of the current system that we have in government schools now is the disproportionate number of non-Malay teachers compared to Malay teachers. So much so that our children going to your normal government school hardly have interaction with adults of different races. At least when I grow up, I have a Chinese, maths, English, chemistry, hockey teacher, you know, Amin was here, our hockey coach was Singh. It's very different. So and when you have the interaction with a person of different background, a different race, who is a lot more mature than you, your perception about interaction, about respect for each other, about learning from each other, is a lot better even than if you were to learn it from among your peers. So I totally disprove that polarization, in order to remove polarization, you have to force people to co-mingle and put, it doesn't work like that. Give them a positive motivation. And the positive motivation means it's better schools, government school, it's better teaching faculty, it's more mixed and variety teaching faculty, and then we can bring back our school system to what it was in the 60s and 70s, whereby the problem of polarization was not as acute as today. From then on, I don't think people will focus on whether or not there should be a vernacular school. it's an option and it will remain an option for the minority.
That's why I mean the need to have a shadow minister to cover on the education, because they need to
collect.
Yeah, it's very easy for you talking from a point of view of a non-government, but not proposing an alternative and how to improve it. That's why we need a people that can follow up it properly, and I can read it and I can judge it by myself what would be the alternative ways of improving it.
We do follow up, Midi, but in parliament you don't get to speak. Yeah, I'm telling you, in parliament, for example, this sitting session begins on 7 October, it will end on, I think, 5th of December. I can only have about 30 minutes to speak, and that's because I'm a shadow finance spokesperson.
Informal
shadow. Yeah. If, for example, you are a normal MP, you dream lah. You do not get to speak, let alone to give a proposal that a government can listen. The best that you could do is to go around ceramah and explain to the people on the ground, and once in a while write articles or publish policy papers. But how many people read policy papers?
That's
1% here.
I was expecting policy proposal from PR. That's the issue. Okay, now you touch on the issue of race, and I would like to talk about that. The thing is, if you read again, because I'm a big fan of Merdeka Center poll results, and one of the findings is that between the age of 21 to 30, majority of the vote is not for PR, it's for BN. Meaning the Malay, young Malays, are in favour with BN. They might feel that maybe the interest of the Malay is not being protected by PR. So why do you think that there is a perception among the Malay that PR is, I don't want to say anti-Malay, but fail to protect the interest of Malay?
I think it's for the voting group 21 to 30, the majority support still went to Pakatan. It's only the youngest first-time voters. Although first-time voters again in total went to Pakatan, but the Malay first-time voters actually was won back by BN in 2013. So that's the survey, the result of the survey. There's a variety of issues. I think at the most rudimentary level, basic level, the goodies that are offered does make a difference to the first-time voters. You know, goodies, brim here, brim there, broom there. So it does make a difference. But I think there's a deeper issue there. I don't think it's just about economic offering. I think race issues has been quite dominant in the last general election. The fear tactics about race does work. We went into the last general election banking on that if we stay focused on bread and butter issues, at least it will avoid from confronting UMNO's race rhetorics, because we didn't want to go into race rhetorics. You cannot fight a racist party unless you become racist yourself, and we can never fight BN by trying to be more racist and more Malay-centric at the expense of others than UMNO. So that's why in the last general election, the whole of our campaign approach manifesto was very much about offering to the public what can be better. We avoided a confrontation on race with UMNO. And I think that's where UMNO had a 1-2% swing with the first-time Malay voters, because the drilling of the race issues among the young Malay voters, more so in the rural areas, did have an impact. This whole idea that if you vote for Pakatan, Chinese is going to take over. When Chinese is going to take over, who's going to pay you? You're not going to get anything. You'll be pengemis in your own state, not knowing that they're already pengemis as it is. It does have an impact to a certain extent. But that's why, generally, you see there's quite an established pattern of support. The first-time Malay voters usually, in the last few years, take side with BN. It is true. But as they grow older, they become 25, 26. By the time they reach 30 and 35, they swing to pakatan. The reason being is that when they were young, whether they are still in university through the process of indoctrination, or kalau they are not university students, the TV and so on, in the indoctrination of the race rhetorics do work. But as they start having a family, they start buying cars, and they start having a mortgage, and a 20 cent price hike starts to kill their pockets, they start hating Rosmah and Najib. So it's a natural process. When they start having a family, the bread and butter issue suddenly becomes more prominent in their consideration for political support. So I don't think it's so much whether Pakatan is anti-Malay or not, because otherwise you would see the same trend across the age voting groups from the first time voters all the way to 50s. But what you see is only the first time Malay voters who are more inclined by about 1-2% to BN. But naturally it changed as they grow older. So I would put it to the race rhetorics on our part in Pakatan. That means that we cannot delay anymore from confronting and contesting the race rhetorics of UMNO Barisan Nasional. We cannot allow a free ride to UMNO, to Ibrahim Ali, to Perkasa, to continuously drill this mindset that Malays are weak, Malays are stupid, Malays cannot stand on our own, because not only is dire for political support, but it's very counterproductive to Malays and nation building. We cannot have a country where the younger generation feel helpless in their own country, and the only way they think that they can be of any considerable influence is by being racist. That's not the way forward. So the responsibility, I think, falls sharply on Pakatan Rakyat to have an effective answer to the race rhetorics that UMNO Barisan Nasional play.
The question after this last question, I want to go back to the issue of two-party system. There's one question that I forgot to ask. So basically, you can see post-2008, there is an emergence, the rise of civil society, C4, Gerakan Masukan Akta Sultan, Gerakan Masukan ISA, Bersih and all. It seems to me that the people are now, that they don't want to be over-reliant to the party, maybe fed up with the two-party, that they decided to assert their influence by their own. So what is your comment on that?
I think you are very young. I think you are extremely young, that your political clock begins in 2008. Actually, the NGO has been there and very active and very important.
Yeah, the sudden flux.
Not really. In fact, if you ask me, I think there has been a decrease in NGOs since 2008. In fact, back then in the 80s, 70s, 90s, when there was no effective opposition, when there is no Pakatan Rakyat and the parties were on their own and very limited clout in national politics, a lot of the critics were carried out by the NGOs. In the 70s, when effectively it was a one-party country with Barisan Nasional, there's no opposition apart from DAP at that time, and there was no Malay opposition, the de facto opposition to the country back then was ABIM, an NGO, in the 70s. You can say the same thing in the 80s and even 90s and so on. And the students' movement was a lot more organized and powerful back then. So I would say actually there is less influx of NGOs after 2008 than before. Now, what is different before and after 2008 is how information disseminates. Before 2008, when you have a lot of these NGOs, but there wasn't too much internet, there was no Facebook, so the NGOs basically were restricted to their core followers, the core team, you know. So if a particular NGO has a membership of 10,000, it's only that 10,000 who moves about. Now, with after 2008 and with internet and Facebook, you can set up a 3-member NGO and create havoc in the country. You know, and that's, I think, contributes to this feeling that there's an influx of NGO. And also after 2008, because the emergence of what some may think as a two-party system, even the NGO begins to realign themselves. You have, you see the NGOs who are very pro-Pakatan, you also see the NGOs who are very pro-PN. So if anything, I think the premise that the so-called rise in NGO is symptomatic of a non-confidence in the political parties and system is flawed. Number one, because I think there is a decrease in NGOs now. Number two, because I think the NGOs themselves begin to align with the either one of the coalitions. Because now there seems to be a clearer directions of how the political parties will carry themselves in this country. So the NGOs then can choose. Previously, the NGOs cannot choose.
Accepting question now? Okay, one, we need, okay, Amin. And another one? Okay, that's two.
Hello, my name is Nazir. So, I just want to ask about when you guys talk about the minority, Rafizi talk about the Bible issue in Selangor, and Midi talk about the Malay races that has been propagated in Malaysia. So I just want to talk about the on the last general election 2008, there's an influx in fusing religion into this conundrum of race prejudice or race problem in Malaysia. So the rise of Arus Baru and other, I won't say the fundamentalist Islam, but a brand of fusing race and Islam in the movement is beginning to take place. So what your take on that kind of issue, and how PR or Pakatan would manage that in terms of you guys have your own problem in Selangor, the Bible issue at least. So thank you.
Kumpul dulu kena.
Hi, I'm Amit. From previous election, there was a complaint from a disabled people. He said that disabled people are isolated by Pakatan, also by BN. So, what are Pakatan's plans on this group of people? And then there's another issue about illegal hawkers from illegal immigrants, and how Pakatan will tackle this issue.
Hi, just want to ask, what efforts are you going to do to bridge the liberalism and conservatism among PR? If so, is it working, and how do PR see itself in the next 10 years?
Okay, I'll start with Nazir's question, which is, I think, the number one concern of the country that should be. I think the fusing of race and Islam, in that matter, in fact, any religion, with when you fuse a religion with race narrative, especially very right-wing race narrative, it can only mean trouble. In any society, you would have the middle ground and you have the fringe. At any particular point, there can be the fringe getting louder and louder and dominating, and therefore setting the undertones of the society, or by right, hopefully, the middle ground will continue to be the silent majority and the dominant force, so that the race right wing will continue to be on the fringe. That certainly is not the case. I think in Malaysia, my personal view, if you see the rise of more and more radical people taking up arms, going to Syria, there's a lot of concerns about radical Islam. Even if you judge subjectively from the kind of comments and view on Facebook among the young ones, yeah, I'm not too old, but slightly older than you guys. It wasn't my generation. It wasn't like that when I was 20s. Malays and Muslims in Malaysia were a lot more open-minded, and a lot less brazen in labeling people and being judgmental about people. That's number one. Going back to Isma, for example, and this Arus Baru, of course, the Lala this year. I, for once, have this huge problem when a race narrative is infused with Islam. Dalam Islam, you know, there's a lot of us here. There's one important ayat, you know, on kalau Allah nak jadikan manusia ini sama semua, Allah boleh buat. Tapi Allah jadikan manusia ini berlainan supaya kita boleh belajar from each other. There's a very important concept di ta'arafu, which is we must learn and know from each other. So, to me, this whole fusion of race and Islam, it just doesn't fit. And only in certain areas, only very restricted to Malaysia, suddenly this narrative that you can only defend Islam if you are a Malay. It just doesn't, how do you, if Islam is a religion, a universal religion with universal value, how do you bring this narrative to, say, Chad? How do you bring this narrative to the southern Siberia? They are not Malay, you know, to the Mongols. So I have a huge difficulty with the brazen infusion of race and Islam, and I think it can only mean danger in Malaysia. Now, the next question is, what leads to this and what Pakatan can do in order to at least mitigate? I think it's just how society progress, you know. If you go to the US and even in Europe for that matter, you'll be surprised how conservative the people are there and how ignorant they are of other people of other faith of other background. If you ask them where Malaysia is, they think Malaysia is in Mongolia, maybe. You know, so that's just how society progress, that the more advancement, the more richer they are, the more sometimes they retract within and they become more ignorant. And that's how what has happened to Malays and Muslims in Malaysia. Over the last perhaps one decade, Malays retract rather than looking outward. We look inward. And therefore, rather than searching for answers and to establish a society that is based on knowledge, on concept, on values, we go for the shortcut. We go for label, we go for, you know, you're either with us or you're not with us, you're either Malays or non-Malays. We go for fear because it's easier. That's also Pakatan's failing, because I think we have take off our focus on this issue for far too long, and that we allow the narrative of Malay Muslims being left to some other groups. And these groups, after 2008 especially, has veered so much to the right, and because they were left unchecked for quite a while and being supported by the establishment to a certain extent, and they had full access to the public, they formed quite a dominant, one of the more dominant worldview in the Malay mind narrative, which is dangerous because that can only lead to more extremism, that can only lead to more misleading understanding or misunderstanding about Islam. So Pakatan Rakyat again has to contest. It goes back to what I said just now. It doesn't run away from the race religion narrative. We thought that it was a nascent issue that we didn't have to confront. I think the developments of the last one or two years prove that it's actually a very pertinent issue in our society, that Pakatan Rakyat has to take the moral courage to confront and to articulate this. That means that we have to not just educate the Malays, but also make the non-Malays and non-Muslims understand that Islam is a lot more beautiful and it's not just meant for the Malays, you know. That Islam encourages understanding and respect for each other. That you can co-prosper in an Islamic society the way that the Jews, the Christians, the minorities has prospered for 1,000 years under the Ottoman rule. These are all lost now. And it's our fault to a certain extent because we spend too much time on the bread and butter and economic issues that we lost focus on the deep ideology narrative that is now plaguing our Malay society.
Yeah, I think you need to answer this question. For the next three questions, maybe 10 minutes maybe.
Okay. Okay, you. They're normal. When you do the manifesto, you cannot include everyone, or even if you include something, it's not enough. Jadi, in the last general election, we did include a paragraph on OKU, which by comparison, in my view, is enough because youth has one paragraph, you know, everyone just have one paragraph because it's a manifesto, it's not a thesis. But it's a normal thing. In any manifesto, there will be groups who think that their interest has not been fully catered for. I think the what is most important, what is different between how Pakatan looks at uplifting the welfare of the OKU is that it's not so much about giving them money, just giving them money or assistance. It's about making it less difficult for them to be a part of society. Currently, it's very difficult. I mean, buildings, facilities are not catered for them. That's just a small problem. A bigger problem is workplace. The economy is not designed to allow for them to take part in it. So it becomes a vicious cycle. If they are OKU, they cannot be part of the economy, and therefore financially somebody has to support them. It goes back to government, and government will continue to give them dole, and it just doesn't work that way. There has not been enough effort, I think, to make sure that OKU will be treated and not discriminated against, not just by buildings, facilities, but by the workings, every working of our society. Your second question is it's quite prominent in my own area, Pandan constituency, is where you have illegals doing business and so on. Difficult, it's very difficult because you tangkap dia ini, so dia tu keluar kat sana, you know. At the very root of it, there's supply and demand. Our people actually rent them houses. Our people also sometimes, more often than not, give them the license and then charge them the license. So for Pasar Malam, for example, the license is given to a local. The local refuse to do work and they say, I give it to you, Indonesian or Myanmar, instead of I selling, you pay me 200 ringgit per night. These people will take it. So while it's a recurring problem and it requires everyone to play their part, you know, that means that enforcement, police, immigration, everything, we have to look the problem in entirety as well, and part of it is how to break the supply and demand, which is so long as our people continue to allow them to be like that, and sometimes they pay to the enforcement officers. So, you know, enforcement, there's a reason why some of them are allowed to continue to operate, because they pay. And our own enforcement officers sometimes continue to take money. So, there's various factors, and you need to fix all these various factors. And that's why I think it's about culture juga lah. It's about our society and government culture. This goes deeper than just illegal selling di tepi jalan, you know. Unless our people understand that, you know, if the permit is given to you, you have to work on that permit. Don't take a shortcut and subcontract and bagi saya work online. Unless our enforcement officers know that, don't take quick money and, you know, take protection money daripada illegals, it will continue to be a problem one way or another. Alan asked a question on basically liberals and conservatives. Actually, it depends, you know. I don't know how you define liberals and conservatives in Malaysia. I don't know how you would rate me. Am I liberal? Am I conservative? I don't know, because Malaysia is our political system and culture and society values are very different from the ones that you have in Europe or in UK or even in Australia or US, where the natural definition of liberalism and conservatism applies. There are always an issue, for example, that will confuse your categorization of whether one is liberal or one is conservative. Take, for example, an issue of Islam. When it comes to voting on issue on Islam, you would find a lot of the Malay Muslims MPs will vote, of course, in defense of Islam. In your normal definition of political inclination, that would have been a conservative grouping, but not necessarily in Malaysia, because you would have the most left-wing MPs, myself included, maybe Nick, we are all very left-wing. We definitely, on issues of religion, I don't think we will stray far from what people in past think. I don't know about UMNO lah, kan? So it's not easy. Now, to your question, how do we reconcile liberals and conservatives? I think you begin by dismantling the label to begin with. Some organizations, even my own party, the moment you begin to have groupings and you give labels to their groupings, it will just highlight the differences between the groups, whereas our main focus and objective is the same, which is a reform of the country and change. And I think because of that, the best thing for us to do is not to begin labeling who are the conservatives, who are the liberals, and you focus on a set of reform agendas, who subscribe to it and who do not subscribe to it.
Continue to engage with YB Rafizi and also the rest of the YBs and state minister that will also be joining us there. So the last question will be, I want to be more personal lah. Your rise in PKR has been meteoric. The first time I met you back in 2007, you was the debate coach.
I was a debating coach.
Yeah, MCKK, yeah, and I was the one who beat you in the team that you coach.
He just had to say that, yeah. Although the judges were entirely not fair, just like SPR.
I've been waiting for that chance to tell the public. So the thing is, in 2012, you single-handedly lead to the dismissal of YB Shahrizad and the whole cow issue. In 2013, you get elected in MP Pandan. Now you are the vice president and suddenly get appointed as a what are your new position?
Secretary General.
Sorry. So it is, your story is eerily similar to the story of the de facto leader of PKR himself, Anwar Ibrahim. His rise in UMNO is meteoric as well. So what is your comment?
PKR is not UMNO.
Yeah. What is your comment about, because there is a recent article saying that, mentioning you as the rise of the new de facto leader of PKR. So what is your comment on that, when people associate you with Datuk Seri Anwar?
I think when people begin to make theories about where your political career will go, that is the beginning of a problem for you, for me personally. I think we are different generation and different type of politicians altogether, because we were very reluctant to become politicians in the first place. My involvement in politics, same as Nick, in fact Nick was younger, Chin Chong and Sim, we all started at your age. And our involvement in politics was because of political awakening, not because we choose to be politician. It's because in 1998, we were awakened from our blissful ignorance as a scholar. In fact, I was working in London, you know. I had no plan for that time being to go back to Malaysia. You know, life was good. But the sacking of Anwar Ibrahim exposed the deep flaw of our society. And it's not really partisan. You know, I actually did not have any big issue with Nor did I have big issue with PAS. But I didn't like it when we were treated like idiots. That's very important. So my generation started in politics at the age of 20, 21. So to your question, you know, some of us have meteoric rise. I think it's because, again, the political clock of some people or some writers begin rather late in 2008 or 2010, not knowing that all of us have started at a very young age, at 21. So I may be 37, but I've been in this party from the very first day that it was set up in the leadership lineup, at 21, at your age. So of course, after 16 years, of course we were young by comparison, but our political experience is as long as anyone else in the party. PKR is very different than UMNO in the sense that we don't have power and we have this obsession about change. In fact, I personally think that my only reason to be in politics is to get rid, to effect a regime change in Putrajaya, because Malaysia needs a second chance from that regime change. I, frankly speaking, don't actually have long-term plan to be politicians for too long. Otherwise, I get grilled by people like him and you all the time. And it's not a nice thing, you know. It's much nicer to be someone else in a cozy office. So, in that sense, I think we are very different from Anwar Ibrahim. We are made up of different generation, different upbringing, different background, but with one common objective. And what unites us, at least in PKR, of different background, different generation, different race, different time, is the agreement that Malaysia needs a second chance from a regime change in Putrajaya. And we all work towards that. That's why I don't think people in PKR sees an appointment as a promotion or a political maneuvering or a rise in political career. There is no political career when you are in opposition. There's no political career. You're just an activist. I am an activist with 3 criminal charges and 5 defamation suits against me, and I can go to jail anytime. Nick can be a state exco with 1 or 2 criminal charges against him. And so you can say the same about Nick, about Sim, you can say the same thing about Chin Chong. We are basically activists. I do not understand when people view us in a different perspective, because we are not a government party. And when you are in opposition, you live on a day-to-day basis knowing at any time you can be taken in and spend the next 2 years resting in Sungai Buloh, for example. So, and therefore, a question of appointment, whether you become a vice president or become a secretary general, is not a question of political mobility. It's a question of who can do the job best. If the best person to bring down Shahrizad Jalil is me, then I did it, because I had to do it, because I'm the best person to do it. If the best person to become a state exco is Nick, because he has the time and experience in the state, so he should be the state exco. It's by no means a testament that he is better than others or his political rise is better than others. And that, I think, is a culture which is very different that we have in PKR as opposed to in UMNO. So I do not see there is any truth in that. I think, you know, my last say ni yang best ni. Lalat dah tak ada dah ni. I think SB yang terlalat dah. Now, my last say to all of you, I was like you, scholars. I don't know how many of you are scholars lah, but I spent long time overseas in the UK. Right after my XPM, I went to public school, did my degree, work in London. Little or hardly anything bother me about what happened in the country. In your view now, you will see things from a completely different perspective. your questions, for example, it's obvious that your question shows that there's a lot of the reality in Malaysia that you do not grapple with from here. So no matter how well you do, at the end of the day, I think you still have to ask your question, this question to yourself: how much difference do you want to make to the society and to the people around you?